It's about you, Lord. Hallelujah. It's about you, Lord. Thank you, Lord Jesus. And so, Father, I pray not only that you are blessed, but that your people would be blessed. My God. And we would not slack to give you worship, glory, and honor that's due your name today. In Jesus' name we pray. Hallelujah. Amen and amen. Hallelujah. Come on, give God a hand clap of praise. Maybe that's what we needed. Amen. Just a little bit of prayer. A little bit of prayer to set the tone. Hallelujah. Thank you for staying with us. Hallelujah. Amen. We got a spirit of determination. We're going to bless God today. I said we're going to bless God today right where you are. Amen. Thank you for your prayers. Would you throw your hands up? Amen. And say, bless the Lord. Hallelujah. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Bless the Lord. Hallelujah. We're getting ready to go. I hope you didn't join us today to be a spectator, but to be a participator in this worship experience. Hallelujah. Amen. Because we come to bless him. Come on, let's go. Let's go. Hallelujah. Amen. In your living room, in your kitchen, you can put your hands together. Oh, it feels real good in here. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Come on. Begin to stir up praise and worship in your living room, in your makeshift sanctuary. Hallelujah. Here we go. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save. I'm gonna say that part again. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. Help me sing. Say you. I'm not afraid of the dark. name right there. Come on, lift his name. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. Come on, lift his name up now. Bless your name, Jesus. Glory. Hallelujah. We worship you, Lord.
Are you hurting and broken within? Overwhelmed by the weight of your sin? Jesus is calling. Have you come to the end of yourself? Do you thirst for a drink from the well? Jesus is calling. Oh, come to the altar. The Father's arms are open wide. Forgiveness was bought with the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Oh, come to the altar.
Come to the altar.
backslider come home. He's calling you. Hallelujah. Thank God. Thank God that he's still calling. I wish somebody would just put that in the comment section. Thank God that he's still calling. Thank God that he is still calling. For I have not called you unto uncleanness, but I have called you unto holiness. Thank God for the holy call on this morning. One more time, put your hands together and give him praise out there. Amen. Certainly we thank God for the minstrels that are in the house this morning. Wonderful job. The singers that are in the house this morning, ushering us into the presence of the Lord. And I don't know about you in your living room, in your kitchen, what the temperature is in your house, but in here it's feeling real good in the sanctuary right now. Hallelujah. For in the presence of the Lord is the fullness of joy. And we bless him on today. Certainly we want to take this opportunity as we shift to now invite you and to encourage you to visit our webpage at www.emmanuelnashville.org, and you can go there and you can sow your seed in your morning offering this morning to sow into the kingdom of God. And we certainly thank God for the faithfulness of those that have been faithful in continuing to sow into the ministry, man, that we're able to push forward, amen, and to advance the kingdom of God. So please, again, you can visit our website at www.emmanuelnashville.org. Likewise, if you would like to sow via Cash App, our handle is $Emmanuel Nashville, Emmanuel Nashville. And then finally, if you would like to sow via mailing it in, you can do so by mailing it to P.O. Box 1196, Hendersonville, Tennessee, zip code being 37077. Amen. I'm grateful this morning. Going to go ahead and get into the word of the Lord, but I tell you, worship always helps the flow of the word. Worship, praise and worship begins to till the ground of the heart and the spirit that allows it to be, to receive the word that comes from the Lord. And the Bible declares that man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God shall man live. So we're going to begin to draw your attention this morning into the book of Acts chapter number 8. And I only want to read verse number 1, Acts chapter 8, verse number 1. And I'll go ahead and confess on camera that I didn't read the Sunday school lesson this morning, but as I was listening to Minister Juan as he began to expound the word of God this morning, and he said, we're turning to the book of Acts, I got excited. And as he began to talk, amen, he talked much about what the Lord had given me. And so we can declare today that there's but one spirit, the spirit of God that is speaking in the earth now. And I believe that this is the word that the Lord would speak to us today from the book of Acts, chapter number 8, verse number 1. And it says, and Saul was consenting unto his death. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. I want to read that again. And Saul was consenting unto his death being Deacon Stephen. And at that time, there was a great persecution against the church, which was at Jerusalem. And they were all scattered abroad throughout the regions of Judea and Samaria, except the apostles. Thus be the reading of the word of the Lord. And today, I believe the Lord wants to speak to us from this subject of a period of transition. A period of transition. Lord, do it now in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of the Lord. A period of transition. The book of Acts is one that is very familiar to us, especially not hinging on the fact of our denomination, but the reality as being Pentecostal, apostolic. The book of Acts is one that is well known to us, well rehearsed unto us, one that we are very familiar with. We understand that the book of Acts is, I would see it as being one of the most important books in relationship unto the shift of the focus of ministry of the Holy Ghost in relationship to not only mankind, but to the universal church at large. This book of Acts, we could possibly coin it as the book of actions, because it is not only the book of Acts or the actions of the apostles, but more importantly, it is the actions and the movings of the Holy Ghost. Therefore, we could consider this book not only to be the book of action, but a book of movement, or as we've coined it today, a book of transition and not a book of tradition. I know I didn't say it exactly right, but you get what I'm going from this. It is a book of transition. It is a book, amen, of moving and actions, and not so much simply a historic account of the birthing of the church in the New Testament. We understand that to be the truth, but rather than to, amen, anchor ourselves and our faith to the traditions of rehearsing those experiences, this book is a book of transition. Amen. We find here in this book not only the outpouring of the Holy Ghost on the day of Pentecost, but consequently, as we look at the book of Acts, we see the transitioning of the focus of the gospel as it was preached unto the Jews. And now we see in the book of Acts how the gospel has been transitioned from the Jew until the Gentile world. When we consider, amen, here this book as a source of background, and we consider, man, the book of Acts, looking at chapters 1 through chapter 7, it is there, amen, as one would coin it or describe it, Acts chapters 1 through 7 as a period of testing. I say it is a period of testing because in these first 7 chapters of the book of Acts, we see now that there is a testing in relationship to the Jews and their acceptance of the kingdom of God as it has been offered unto Israel. We see now, looking at the book of Acts a third time, because, amen, of the Holy Ghost, we see now, amen, that God is offering the kingdom of God unto the Jews. First, we see recorded in the book of Matthew. In the book of Matthew, chapter number 3, there we see that John the Baptist came on the scene in the New Testament. And John now comes preaching, the Bible declares. John came preaching the gospel of the kingdom. And we see now that as John is preaching the gospel of the kingdom, we see the rejection, the ultimate rejection of the Father himself that sent John. As we read in history that John was beheaded for the preaching of the gospel. Thank you, Lord. Consequently, as we are approaching this book of Acts, amen, and in the book of Acts, we see there that there are 3 murders that are marking out Israel's rejection of the kingdom message. Number 1, we see Israel rejected John the Baptist, whom Jesus Christ himself declared that there's no greater prophet that has arisen of a woman than was greater than John the Baptist himself. But John came preaching and declaring the gospel of the kingdom. And those that heard this message beheaded John in their rejection of the Father. Secondly, we see now the second rejection of this kingdom message in Matthew chapter number 4, verses 12 through 16. For it is there, as we begin to read of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, how that Jesus himself came declaring the same message that John came preaching, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. We know how it turned out for the Son of Man. Amen. For they crucified him in their rejection of the Son. Ironically, as we see their rejection of the Son, it is then the prayer of the Son. Thank you, Lord. It is the prayer of the Son. Father, in the book of Luke, chapter number 23, verse 34. It is the prayer of the Son. Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. In other words, I know that they are rejecting this message a second time. But Father, I want you to give them one more opportunity. I know they have rejected you, Father, and have now crucified the Son. But it is ironically the prayer of Jesus himself that made it possible for the apostles to come on the scene in the book of Acts to now offer a third time. Yes, God, a third and complete time of the offering of the kingdom of God. Stay with me now. Well, as we're reading now, thank you, Lord. In these first seven chapters of the book of Acts, we find the seventh chapter closing here. Amen. The Jews reject for a third time the message of the kingdom of God. For we see that as Stephen, Deacon Stephen, is ministering of the grace of God in the face of Jesus Christ, how that those that heard Stephen, the Bible says not only were they pricked in their hearts, but they wanted to gnash upon him with their teeth, and so they stoned the witness of Stephen. Three times in history, it is recorded here in the gospel that the Jews in their totality have rejected the message of the kingdom of God. Number one, in John's preaching, they rejected the Father that sent John. Number two, in the preaching of the Son, Jesus Christ himself, the crucifixion of Christ, was their second rejection of this message. And then finally, the Bible declared in Acts chapter number 7, verse number 51, amen, that as they have stoned Stephen, amen, the Bible declares that they have committed the unpardonable sin because they have now rejected and resisted the Holy Ghost. Thank you, Lord. I wish you put it in the comment section. Do not resist the Holy Ghost. This marks now their total and complete rejection, not of the Trinity, but of the Godhead. Amen. The totality of the essence of God, which is comprised in Jesus Christ. They have now rejected this gospel and the idea of the kingdom now. I'm almost where I need to be. I believe, brothers and sisters, that it is important now that we consider, amen, as we look at the book of Acts, amen, the significance of Acts chapter number 2 and Acts chapter number 8 and Acts chapter number 10. Would y'all slow the clock down for a minute? Thank you, Lord. When we look now at Acts chapter number 2, we see now the importance of the outpouring of the Holy Ghost. This is the falling or the coming of the promise of the Father that has come up on them and introduced them now to the abiding and the indwelling presence of the Holy Ghost in them. My God, but not only, First Lady, do we see the outpouring of the Holy Ghost, but we see transition in progress. For as we move to chapter number 8, amen, 8 being in biblical numerology, 8 is the number of new beginning. We see now that transition has begun after the death of Stephen. For the Bible declares now that the gospel now is moved from Jerusalem and is now moved into Samaria. Thank you, Lord. As we look at chapter number 8, we see Philip the deacon evangelist. The Holy Ghost now inspires Philip to go down now to Samaria. He gets down there and preaches the word of God. And the Bible declares that some hear and believe. The word got back to headquarters in Jerusalem. And the apostle Peter heard the word. And the Bible declares that Peter and the brethren left Jerusalem and went to Samaria, amen, to witness the faith of those new converts. And the Bible declares that when Peter had heard and saw their faith, I'm paraphrasing y'all, that when he heard and saw their faith, the Bible declares that Peter laid his hands upon them and they received the Holy Ghost, speaking in other tongue. Thank you, Lord. So we see now the transition from Jerusalem out into the land of Samaria. It moves us to chapter number 9, y'all, where we find now Saul, who was now transfigured and translated to the man named Paul. And we see now that God has transitioned the message simply from the Jew to the Samaritan, and he's getting ready to move to the Gentile. I'm almost where I need to be. Yes, Lord. And so when Paul is converting, amen, the Bible declares that he goes into a period of education, if you will, because God now is focusing the ministry of the gospel to the Gentile world. Moving us to chapter number 10, we see now in chapter number 10 that this transition has been completed when we are now introduced to a man by the name of Cornelius. Thank you, Lord. And in Cornelius's case, the Bible declares that he lived in the land of Caesarea, which is Judea. So we see now this message, the message of the gospel has left the church in Jerusalem and it's moved out to Samaria, and now it's in Judea. Have we forgotten the message and the commission of the Lord Jesus Christ when he spoke to his disciples in Acts 1 and 8, and he declared, and after that you have received the Holy Ghost. He said, after that the Holy Ghost has come upon you, you shall receive power, and you're going to be a witness, not just in Jerusalem, he says, but in Judea and in Samaria. Thank you, Lord. And in the uttermost parts of the world. Yes, Lord. So what we see now is the fulfillment of what Jesus' mandate was to his disciples and to the 21st century church. I need to tell us before my time gets away that the first one-fourth of the book of Acts was written that a 7 chapters out of 28 chapters were written to the Jews for their acceptance of the kingdom of God for the sake of salvation. But because they rejected him because of their tradition, he said, I gotta transition this thing. Yes, Lord. And as I began to look at this last night, I began to hear the Spirit of the Lord speaking in my ear. Thank you, Lord. And the Spirit of the Lord began to say these words to me. He said, transition or traditional expression and experience, which is the lack of diversity in our experience and expression, it leads us to traditional reproduction. In other words, when you don't have Abraham, when you simply got tradition, you're replaying and reproducing what has already been void of authentic expression and void of authentic experience. But when you had a person, an individual expression and experience, it becomes a diverse and organic experience that brings authenticity and unadulterated reproduction and expression. Simply put like this, what you get is real and not rehearsed. I wish you put that in the comment section. When you have a real encounter with God, not one based off of your tradition at the church house, but when you have a real encounter with God, it'll be real and not rehearsed. And that's what the church was doing at Jerusalem. They were simply rehearsing what they had experienced. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I'm almost finished. But I need to tell us that there is a difference between production and reproduction. Production, or to produce, it means to generate or to yield. But reproduction means to produce or to make a copy. A copy of something. But the problem, Christian, my God, Christian, with reproduction is that at times, while you may reproduce the image, you may not reproduce the essence. While you might reproduce the image, you will not reproduce the substance. And that's what I see in the book of Acts, chapter number 8 and 9. The gospel according to grace for the advancement of the kingdom of God. And as the gospel is spreading, my God, because of the persecution of the church, because the church had to go in underground, because the church had to go into the homes, we see the gospel getting out now. Thank you, Lord. Yes, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I got to draw this thing to a close. What we see now in the book of Acts, y'all, is that the gospel message has left the church house and has now come to our houses. And that's what we see now. And as the gospel began to spread, then the church began to spread. My God, because of the trouble, my God, the transition that trouble ushered them into. And this is what the Bible declares. As I come to my close now, I hear the word of the Lord in Acts chapter number 8. It began with the word, and the church was under great persecution. But after this transition, my God, by the time that we get to Acts chapter 8, verse number 8, just 7 verses later, we find that great persecution, it turned out to be great joy, because souls were added, they were added to the kingdom. And what I see today is what I see in the book of Acts now. It's the same dynamic at work. Persecution, it only opened the door for soul winning. Traditional church recycles. Thank you, Lord. I'm going to say that again. Traditional church experiences, they simply recycle, reclaim, and continue to need to revive those that have already been saved. This tradition is demanding, amen, the same old, same old. But in this period of transition,
I'm gonna say it again, but in this period of transition, God is calling for something different from the church. The church is still to be the pillar of ground and truth. It teaches us how to behave ourselves. It teaches us how we ought to approach God. But the church isn't to be the end all be all. It is the institution of education for those have been converted to the faith. But we still need, my God, in the middle of this pandemic, we still need somebody that's had an authentic experience that's not reproducing tradition, the tradition of two songs, my God, the offering, my God, a prayer, a poem, and a closer. But we need a word from the Lord. We need a word like they had. We need a word like they had in the book of Acts that said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have give I thee in the name of Jesus Christ. I wonder, is there anybody out there that knows there's still power in the name of Jesus? Power over cancer in the name of Jesus. Power over sickness and disease in the name of Jesus. Power over depression in the name of Jesus. It's a period of transition. It's a changing of the guard. It's a changing. Thank you, Lord. My time is gone, but I feel a shift in the air. It's not an annihilation and a doing away with the church of the living God, but it's an added dimension. It's an added dimension of grace in the middle of this pandemic, that somebody will open up their mouth and declare to a dying world that Jesus, he still lives. It does not matter what they say in the White House. Jesus, he still lives. And not only does he live, not only does he live, but I know that he reigns. He reigns supreme. He's in power. All power that be are ordained of God. He is the supreme power. He is the Ancient of Days. He is our deliverer. He is our way maker. He is our sustainer. In the midst of a pandemic, he is our protection. As a matter of fact, he is a wheel in the middle of a wheel. He'll bring you through and he'll bring you out in this period of transition. Somebody shout hallelujah.
I'm stopping. The book of Acts is significant to the movement of the church and the movement of the Holy Ghost in the church and in the life of the individual believer. And I came to declare that in this period of transition, we said it before the pandemic, no more church as usual. Now that's a raw reality for many. We can't gather like we used to. We can't sing like we used to. We're hesitating to lay hands like we used to. Come on, somebody. It doesn't look like church as usual, but I came to tell you God came to put us in the trouble of transition, to move us in this period that the gospel might get out. Not that we would stay secluded in our homes with our mouths shut, but every opportunity that we find, every opportunity that we have, Bible declared about the church that was under persecution during the diaspora of Paul, persecution coming through Jerusalem. Bible declares that those went out, they spread out, that everywhere they went preaching the gospel, building the church, which is an aspect of the kingdom of God. I've come to tell you that we can't put all our eggs in one basket of the traditions of the church. He told him in the book of Luke, I believe it is, he says, your traditions have limited the Holy One of Israel. We've become so complacent with the traditions of church that we're not even aware of the lack of the moving of the power of God in the church of the living God. But I believe that God is ushering us back to a raw place, a place not of people's acceptance of our expression. The acceptance of our expression oftentimes is tethered to tradition. That's what we're used to, so that's what we accept. But as he got this message out to the Gentile world, they didn't get saved like the Jews did by circumcision. They didn't get saved like the Jews did by the traditions of Judaism. They got saved by the moving of the Spirit. And as they heard the word, the Holy Ghost fell upon them. They began to speak in tongues. They did not stop there. They declared, amen. He said, who are we to forbid these that they should receive water, that they should be baptized, seeing as they have received the Holy Ghost like as we. We heard them speak in tongues. Now we're going to complete the process of baptism in the only name that heaven recognizes. If you're watching me today and you've not been baptized in that name, if you're watching me today, you've not been in relationship. You are not in relationship, right relationship with the Lord Jesus Christ. The song said he's calling. He's calling you to the altar. I want you to call the number that's on the screen, 615-847-3461. I want you to call that number. I want you to talk to us. We want to talk to you and explain to you more plainly the way of the Lord, that you might receive this great salvation that has appeared to all men. I love you. I'm praying for you that you would heed his voice. In the day that you hear my voice, don't harden your heart. Precious heart, come to Jesus. Come to Jesus just now. Come to Jesus. He will save you. He will save you just now. God bless you. Heaven smile upon you is my prayer always. Lord, help us to have one mind. And let that mind be the mind of Christ. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless. Thank you.